Dear galactic beings, get ready for the nerdiest niche topics, the most interesting ideas, and the most absurd discoveries from computers, art, and the world. Operation Mindfuck, directly from RC3 World to your home and into your minds and hearts. Please welcome your hosts, Bleeptrek and Blinry.
Hi everyone at RC3, this is Bleeptrek and Blinry, and we are already back to our yearly little talk about computers, art, and other curious stuff. And yeah, we reached volume 4 this year, so this is the 4th episode of this talk. And if you want to watch the older talks, you can find them on Blinry's website. They are all called Operation Mindfuck. And yeah, have fun with them. I think the older ones are, some of them are in German, and now we do them in English, so more people can have fun. And the talks work as follows. We have prepared different, very small topics, and we will explain them in alternating order. And today, Blinry will start with an interesting variation of keyboards.
That's right. It's not the kind of keyboards you might be thinking about right now. But it's about musical instruments. So this is about isomorphic keyboard layouts. Because in the beginning of this year, I was like starting to learn how to play the piano. And I was like researching a bit of how that system works, basically, and started getting a bit frustrated with it for the following reason. I can't give you a whole intro about music theory right now, but what you need to know is that like these little keys on the piano keyboard like are specific notes, and the distance between them is always one semitone. Yeah, one semitone between them. And they are arranged in this linear fashion, basically. And then if you want to play some part, what you do is that you count the right number of steps between these notes. So, for example, to play a major chord, what you do is always you start at the bass note, and then you count 1, 2, 3, 4 for the second note of this chord, and then 1, 2, 3 for the third. And you press those three together, and then you have a major chord, which sounds like this pleasant, positive chord, right? But then there is this weird property of this keyboard where it's designed in a way so that if you play all the right keys on the keyboard, you get the scale in C major. Yeah, you can like just play the whole scale from C to the next C. And the black keys are the ones you would skip in the scale. And because of that, if you start your major chord at a different note, like, I don't know, F sharp, for example, you do the same counting. You would count 1, 2, 3, 4 for the second note, and then 1, 2, 3 for the third. But now the shape is a bit different. Yeah, you start playing on black keys, and sometimes you like have to mix them. If you start playing a D major chord, you have one black key and two white ones, for example, which is a strange property of this keyboard, I thought, because often when you play a song, you play it in a like in a specific transposition. Yeah, you start playing at a specific tone, and you by moving all of the notes up and down by a specific amount, and then you have to kind of to relearn how to play all these chords and the melody, because they will have this different shape. Your fingers have to do different things, and I thought this was really weird, and I like researched a bit about that, and the first thing I found, I think, was this instrument, which is like called the Dodeca, which is just the name the company is giving this thing, where actually all the semitones are arranged next to each other without a specific shape. I think still the black keys here are like the C, the middle C or something here, to give you an impression of where you are in the scale. But then you have the 12 semitones until the next C, just arranged in a linear fashion, meaning that if you know the shape of the major chord, for example, like you count 4 and you count 3, you can move this shape anywhere on the keyboard to like move it up and down, which I think is pretty cool. I back then I asked a specific person who knows how to play keyboards really well in the Wikidata community, what might be the reason for this like strange layout. And they gave me two reasons. One was that if you have this shape with a black key sticking out, you can kind of feel where you are on the keyboard when you play it, which makes sense, I guess. Sure. And the other reason is that like the classical music notation also uses that system where like notes which are directly on the lines or in the gaps of this like classical music notation are the right keys on a piano keyboard. And if you put a B or a cross in front of it, you would use the black keys. So that kind of fits together, and to change the layout, you would like change the past few hundred years of music notation, which I think might be worth it. But yeah, there are some even more advanced ways to arrange the notes. And they use hexagonal keys, which I think is really cool. So this is the harmonic table layout, where like you arrange the notes according to this diagram here. If you are at a specific tone, like a C here, and you want to go to the C sharp, you move like one key to the right over these columns here, right? And like if you go diagonally up to the right, you do a major third, which is four semitones. And if you go diagonally to the left, it's three semitones. So basically to play a major chord, for example, you would push the bass key, like the C. And then in addition, you go four semitones up to the E, right? And then this one above it is always seven semitones up. So to play a major chord, you would like kind of, you can play this with one finger, yeah? You press your finger in the middle of these three, and then you have a major chord. And to do a minor chord, which is like this sad sounding sound, you can press your finger at this corner here. This would be a C minor chord. And this is a really cool property. The harmonic table layout has some properties which make it pretty weird. For example, to go an octave up, you have to do a really big jump. Yeah? You have to jump from this C up to all the way over here, which is kind of inconvenient. So people also came up with another arrangement called the Vicky Haydn layout. I think this was invented in the 19th century already, where you, if you start at a specific key, you go a whole step to the right. This is like two semitones. And then if you go diagonally up to the right, you have seven semitones, perfect fifth. And to go an octave up, you go two rows up. And this is a pretty nice layout. And I can just show you how this works actually, because people made like a web-based demo around this. So you get this hexagonal grid. If we start at a D, for example, and want to play a major chord now, what we do is we go four semitones up, right? So we end up at the E. And then we add one that is seven up from the original bass note, so it's a G. And you can actually play this on your keyboard, like by pressing the E and G. You have a major chord, and now again you can move this shape around anywhere. So if I start here and press these sounds, it's a major chord, or another one here, one here. And yeah, the minor chord is just another symmetric version of this. So starting at C, we add this one and this. This is minor, this is major. And you can start transposing specific keys up and down. Like this is the first inversion of the chord. And yeah, this is, for me, this was really surprising to see that you can build a structure like this. And then if you remember the shape of a melody, you can just transpose it anywhere, which is cool. People are actually building hardware for this. So this is something people call a jammer keyboard. And if you're interested in this, you will find a small community around this who like build their own input devices like this. And also, while preparing this talk, I learned that accordions, specifically accordions, also use a string to places where you put your hands. And one of them is used for playing chords. And the other one, some of them use like a piano key layout. But some others, like this one, also have like an isometric layout where I think it's another variation of this, where if you move diagonally up, it's one whole step. And to go up means to go two whole steps, basically. And that defines this layout. But then it's, again, really easy to play a melody and move it someplace else and play it another key. Yeah. Bina, what have you prepared next?
All right, so I like a lot to work with generative art, and tiles and tiling is a super simple way to make really fancy pattern. And 2 years ago, I looked a bit deeper into ratchet tiles, and that's still really fascinating to me. So I thought it might be a nice topic today to show you a bit around ratchet tiles. So this was basically the first version. So the idea of ratchet tiles is that you have rectangular tiles that are not symmetric along their x and y axis. So for this example, or these are the first proposed ratchet tiles, are these four tiles on the top that are basically made of that are rotated by 90 degrees, so you get all the variations that you can make out of them. Now you can use these tiles to make larger patterns, so you put them in a large grid, and you have different possibilities to do so. For example, the left version, I'm not sure, the mouse is recorded. For example, like the left version here, you can just throw in always the same tile and you get a very nice repeating pattern. But maybe it's a bit boring and you wouldn't really need tiling for that, but that's also possible. But you can also say like you go an alternating route and like switch them every second place. So you get like a bit of a mosaic shape, and you can also play around more with that and place them in very certain ways and directions to create bigger patterns. And that's usually what I find really interesting. And of course you can just place them randomly, like the example below here, which also makes a really intriguing pattern to me. It's maybe a bit, like it's not so quiet. It's sometimes a bit exhausting to look at, but it's fun to see patterns emerge that are not planned. So this is the earliest version of the ratchet tiles. And I think this version here, this is basically an derivative of the tiles that I just showed you. Maybe you know that one. This is called TenPrint. And this was is a basically super famous way of pattern generation where you just put diagonal lines instead of triangles. And in this case, you'd have basically only two tiles, right? You have that line that is flipped to the right, and you have the line that is flipped to the left side, and you can place them randomly. And this 10-print pattern became so famous because you can just write more or less a one-liner in nearly any coding language. And this came up in the area, in the time of BASIC, where you can just write a one-liner in BASIC and have your whole screen filled with a random nice pattern. So this is also a derivative of ratchet tiles, actually. But these are the ones that I think most people know when they think of ratchet tiles. It's a version where you don't work with rectangles or lines, but you have parts of like quadrants of circles placed in the edges. And in this case, you can't make four tiles, you can only make two, because if you rotate them by 90 degrees, third flip, so you can only get two. And when you place them in a random order, that's the example you can see below, you get a super fancy pattern that basically contains of either you can accidentally basically form a whole circle, or like parts of circles that get entangled and form super long lines. And that looks really fun. And this is also the first picture that I saw of Clutcher tiles. And I found that very intriguing. And well, you can, turns out you can do even more cool stuff with that. For example, I need to find my mouse. Here we go. you can basically, you can start scaling the pattern in different ways. And for example, you can use it for dithering. So here the background image is the image of Mona Lisa, as you might have recognized. And you can take the image darkness and then scale your pattern accordingly to that point on your image. So you get sort of a dithering, and it looks super fancy. And what I also found recently, what I think is exceptionally good looking, is a very special way of scaling Clutcher tiles by Christopher Carlson. And he published a paper at Bridges. Bridges is a super nice math and art conference, or I'm not sure if it's a whole conference or more like a workshop, but they have super nice papers. So if you're interested in like these intertwined math and art stuff, look into these papers. They're super cool. And Christopher Carlson came up with a nice way and a nice aesthetic of having these scalable Clutcher tiles. And you can see these are three scale sizes. So this is basically the original size, and then you go one step smaller, and you can see that he, in his case, he works with white and black areas, and you can now combine them in ways. For example, this is a super, super quick and easy example. So here on the left side, you have that large tile, and you add on the right side two of the smaller tiles, and you can see that the positive, let's for the big one, let's say the dark one is the positive space, that your white space or your negative space here becomes the positive space in the next smaller scale. So this is also always iterating when you go one scale step smaller. And now you can think about, how can I combine these different scale scales, and he had he prepared some examples. So for example, the left one, it's more or less like a quad tree, so you can just choose a rectangle and divide it by four, and you get one scale smaller, and you can do this recursively, randomly basically. Or you can also do it in the form of a pattern, or maybe in a certain shape. So when you want to approximate certain outlines, you can go smaller there. To reach a certain shape. And when you fill that in with these tiles, you get this result. And that looks super fancy, especially the left one. For my taste, is super awesome and looks really, really nice. And he even, in his paper, he even goes one step further and thinks about different additional motifs that he could do with these different scales. So I'm not sure if these would be considered Clutcher tiles, because they lose this not symmetrical attribute in some occasions, like the TS version here that would be symmetrical along this axis. So I'm not sure if these would actually be considered Clutcher tiles, but it looks nice, so who cares? So he made different versions that can also be applied or added to that set of tiles. So you just have, basically, you have these four entry or exit points, like on the top, bottom, left, and right, and you need to have at least a circle there, or connect your entry or exit points in different ways. And he just tries out different shapes. And if you add this to the regular scaling Clutcher tiles, you get these results, and that looks super fancy, because you have very very nice fitting shapes that are still super randomly distributed. And so this is where I think I should stop, maybe talk about tiles. But if you want to fall into a rabbit hole, we have rabbit holes prepared at the end also. But if you want to go further into tiling, especially, maybe check out Penrose tiling. This is such a huge and fancy and complex topic that I think that it would fill several of its own talks, but if you want to dig further, I can also highly recommend Penrose tiling. That's it. So I will give back to Blinry.
Yeah, Penrose tiles might be a topic for some operation mindfuck in the future, right? Yeah. This section is titled, What Even Is Art? I'm often really fascinated by like artworks and art installations which kind of push the boundary of what's still considered to be an artwork. And I wanted to show you some of those. For example, last year there was an Italian, Maurizio Cattelan, who just bought a fresh banana at a grocery store and like taped it to the wall of a museum and then declared this as art. The title is Comedian. And because Cattelan is rather well known and popular, this was also worth a surprising amount of money. I think this was like $120,000 was what an American couple paid for this artwork to buy it. And after the sale took place, the following thing happened. Another man walked up to this artwork and like explained to the people watching and recording this that this was an art intervention called Hungry Artist, and just said it was very tasty and that he didn't want to be disrespectful to the original artist, but this was an intervention. And this artwork came with a kind of certificate that said that you had really bought it and that it's yours now. And it specifically mentioned that you can replace the banana as needed. So after this happened, it was just like people bought a new one and taped it to the wall again, and that it was repaired. But yeah, I like this combination of these two artworks interleaving with each other. I think this artist was like, he was asked to leave the museum, but nobody pursued legal action. Oops. The next artwork I'm going to show you has to do with this material, which you might have heard about. It's called Vanta Black, and it's one of the darkest materials known to humankind. It's a specific, like it's on a microscopic level, it has nanotubes which are parallel and like kind of sticking up from the surface where this paint is on. And then if a light ray falls on the surface, it kind of gets trapped between these little tubes and can't escape anymore, which is why it looks so pitch black. I think like there are numbers where people state that this swallows 99.4% of visible light or something. This was developed a few years ago by a company for pretty diverse applications. But there was an artist who was really interested in this, Anish Kapoor, a British Indian artist, who had like who was interested in playing with black color anyway. And they came to an agreement where they said that Kapoor was the only artist allowed to use Vanta Black in artworks. So one example is this one, Descent into Limbo, which Kapoor had already made installations of like many years back. But in a recent like revival of this artwork, he actually painted the insides of this with Vanta as a hole that's several meters deep. And because he was using this special paint, you can't really see the shape of it. And at one point, like there was a visitor to this artwork who like tried to look into this hole and didn't believe that this was actually a hole and tried to step into it and fell in and had to be rescued after that. This situation where only Kapoor is allowed to use this color made several people really angry. For example, there's another artist called Stuart Semple, who's making his own like pigments, color pigments. And he designed the world's pinkest pink one time. And this is like the store website where you can buy this pigment, which states that it's available to everyone except Anish Kapoor. Yeah, out of a kind of a revenge action. And if you like click on the buy it now button, you actually have to like verify that you are not Anish Kapoor and you have no plans to share it with him. Well, sometime later, Anish Kapoor posted this picture on a social media channel. So apparently someone had broken this contract and sent Kapoor some of this pigment. Well, and yeah, I think Stuart Semple was really, really angry and disappointed about this and asked him to give it back, but also didn't have really any means to take legal action against this. You might have heard of Banksy, who's an English street artist who like chooses to remain anonymous. And he's like well known for making graffiti on just walls in the street somewhere. But at this point, he also is so famous and well known that he's starting to like sell his artworks. For example, this is a painting like with a girl with a heart-shaped balloon. And this went up for auction in an auction house some years ago. And yeah, because Banksy is such a mystery and so popular, this is also worth a surprising amount of money. I think over $1 million was paid for this at this auction. And after like the hammer fell and this was sold, the following happened. I can show you the video, or the thumbnail kind of gave it away there. So this is being sold. And then like a loud beeping noise was heard. And this artwork just was sucked into the frame of itself, which shredded the artwork. And actually, Banksy had prepared this stunt in several years in advance, yeah, and built like the shredding device into the frame. Probably he or someone he know was present at this auction and pressed the remote control button to activate this system. So this is an example of self-destructive art, which maybe not so surprisingly made it worth even more. I think at this point it's valued at around $3 million. So yeah. Also, it was supposed to shred itself completely, but apparently some of the mechanism failed, and so it's now half shredded. And yeah, I think I had that on the slide here. It's now called Love is in the Bin after the stunt. This is an artwork, the last one I want to show in this section, by the German artist Josef Beuys, who is often working with unusual material. And yeah, this is an artwork consisting of several kilograms of butter. It's called Fettecke, which translates to fat corner, literally. And he just took the butter, put it in the corner of your museum, and let it stay there for many years, which I'm pretty sure developed an interesting smell. But yeah. And after Beuys died, the custodian of the gallery where it was exhibited accidentally cleaned it up. You might have heard of that before. He didn't know what it was about and just removed it and put it in a trash can. And one of the students of Beuys was really angry about this and like went to the trash can and recovered it and like treasured the remains really deeply. And I think also received a payment from the custodian because of this destruction. And then I also learned that not very long ago, a couple of artists like got these remains of the butter and distilled a liquor from it. I have a picture of it here. This is, yeah, even another artistic intervention on top of this. Yeah. So this is a really strong liquor, and they tasted it and said that it tasted really strongly of cheese. that's all the strange artworks I wanted to show you in this section. Bitte.
Oh, amazing, amazing. I think that's where the German question, is that Kunst oder kann das weg, comes from, right? Like, is it art or can I remove that? Oh, perfect. Yeah, let's stay with art. So I really a lot enjoy watching machines work, and especially pen plotters, and they are perfect to produce art. And I never, in an Operation Mindfuck talk, I never showed you different types of pen plotters and realized that's actually really interesting because they are quite different constructions. So let's do a small walk through the history of pen plotters. And this is, to my knowledge, one of the oldest pen plotters. It's a Zuse Graphomat. And this one, I took the photo in the Technical Museum in Berlin. It's an exhibition there, and I think it's in a permanent exhibition there. Sadly, it's not running, but I think they can run it. At least that piece of paper that is in the machine looked to me like they plotted it on place. It could be. I'm not really sure, but it would be extremely awesome. And these are what you can't really see on these photos is that these are like huge devices. If you stand before that, it's like over a meter long or over a meter deep, I guess. And it's like, I think it's also a bit, maybe, yeah, like it's in about a one meter square, like it's super huge, and it just can grab a pen and draw. It's nothing else that it can do. But of course, it's also a quite old machine, and there is a person called Georg Nies who worked at Siemens in the 60s and 70s, and he was one of the pioneers of generative art and plotter art, and he bought one of these Zuse Graphomat machines for Siemens at that time, and it was an extremely modern and futuristic thing to have, like a machine that can plot. Yeah, you must imagine there were no printers. Everything was also in architecture was of course still drawn by hand. So these machines that can draw extremely precise lines, this is totally fancy. And what you can also see are these pens and ink on the bottom. These isograph pens, you can still buy them, and they are still extremely expensive, but they are really nice for pen plotting because they work a bit different than most other pens. They have a metal nib, a very flat metal nib, and along this nib, the ink will get sucked out or runs down. And the nib is completely flat because the pen is meant to be used like on the point and dragged along on the point, because most modern pens like roll tip pens will not really like that if you use them like directly in 90 degrees on the paper. So these are the Graphomats are basically the first drawing machines. And a few years later, you will find machines that were more usable for companies, and they have the size like of a regular printer or maybe a bit bigger for A3 plotters. And this one is from HP, and you can see that our Hackspace had quite a lot of fun with it and tried to get it to work again. And in this model, for example, works in a way that the paper is moved forwards and backwards, and the pen, that's the blue thing you can see here. This is basically, right there too. Like these are, you can store one, and you can put one pen in this device, and the pen can only like move left to right, and the paper will be dragged along. Along with two little wheels, basically. These are here and here. And then you can plot. These are one kind of the devices that you can find a lot still on your local Craigslist. And these are the other ones. This one is a Roland pen plotter, and it completely moves along two axes, so the paper stays in place. And these Roland plotters, they have some really nice features. For example, you can see that the plotter is standing up a bit, and the bed is an electrostatic bed. So you can put your paper on, press a button, and the paper gets sucked to that bed. That's super fancy. And also on the left side here, oops, I lost my screen sharing for some reason.
I still see it.
Ah, it's back. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm not sure. It's back. like on the left side here, these are like basically parking stations for pens. So the pen plotter can colors or exchange different pens on itself. That's super fancy. And if you want to get one of these older pen plotters, make sure that they are not too hard to communicate with, and make sure that they can do the thing that you want them that they can do. Because, for example, these older HP plotter, that was really hard to talk to, because it did only speak a very sort of proprietary language. And only the newer HP plotters started to speak HPGL. And the Roland plotter also can do this, for example, and or Roland also has its own language. So just make sure you know what the device wants to speak to with you, because this can make your life a lot easier. and these older plotters, they also often have a nice function that they have a direct text mode. So you need to boot them in a certain way, like flip some switches on the backside, and they will boot into a text mode. So you can just send text over on over serial, and it will just write that down, has its own matrix of letters and its own font store in it. And that's super fun and makes a great tutor wall plotter, for example. And then there are also a lot of DIY homebrew sort of plotters. And this one is maybe the one that's the easiest to build. You can find them under the name Michelangelo or Polargraph. I think these are the two most common names for these. And they work super differently. So on the left and on the right side, on the top here and over here, you have two motors, and also you need to some sort of a control device or a little computer. And around these motors, you will find a string that is attached in the middle to a gondola that can hold a pen. And that gondola usually also has a servo motor that can push away that gondola from your drawing area, so you can lift and put down your pen. And to make this more stable, you usually put down some weight on the left and right side, so that the string string has some force on it and it works better. These are super easy to build, and there are really nice communities around them. And the very positive thing about these construction is that they scale extremely well. Because like the way the old Roland plotters, for example, worked, you have these two axes that can move, and you are very defined on how long these axes are. But with this, you can basically scale it indefinitely. And I've seen some installations where they like plotted over a whole 5-meter wall with these, because you just need to have a very long string, and that's basically all. That's super fun. So if you want to build one yourself, this is a very nice way to go. But there are also new commercial versions that are quite fun. This one is called Linus. It's super tiny and basically only consists of, I guess, two servo motors and a little Arduino or something. It can only draw on a super, super tiny area. And it's so wiggly. No matter what, it can't draw a straight line, but it's super cute to watch and super easy to take with you, and has some nice APIs, and it's quite hackable. So that's also a really neat device. And well, this is basically, I think, the most professional one that you can buy up to date, which is called AxiDraw. But I've also seen some self-built versions of this. You also have your two axes. There's a little controller board over here. And the fun thing here is that you can put in very different types of pens here. For example, is a fountain pen. But you can basically put any pen in that you want that's different to the old plotters. They had very specific very little specific plotter pens, and they are really expensive now if you want to buy them. And with the AxiDraw, you can basically use whatever you want. And you can also put your pen in a certain angle, and that's especially nice for fountain pens or sort of brushes. And I've seen a lot of people not only using pens, but also going to use acrylic paint or very different materials. Or also, I've seen one example where someone just basically put in a sort of a toothpick and drew onto some sort of flat clay and made pattern in that. And that's super fun. So you're not limited to use pens, but yeah, be creative and use all kinds of stuff. So if you ever come around some sort of pen plotter, try it. It's super fun for a very quick and nice creative coding output.
I really love how plotters combine this kind of handmade aesthetic, which impositions and stuff, with this digital input.
That's totally.
And I think people sometimes joke that it's easier to get these plotters to run and to like produce something compared to like actual printing devices we would use currently, like printing on a piece of paper because of driver issues and stuff. And these are very clear defined languages, yes. I wanted to show you some RFCs. That abbreviation is short for Request for Comments. And it's a really common way to define protocols for the internet, of how the internet works. For example, TCP and IP would be defined in RFCs, and HTTP, and how mails work and stuff. And yeah, there are several thousand of those. And sometimes people publish RFCs on April Fool's Day. And these are sometimes really interesting to read. One really well known, for example, is RFC 1149 IP over avian carriers, which suggests to use like carrier pigeons to carry information from one place to another. So it specifies that you should like put your information on a piece of paper and roll it around the leg of a pigeon and then send it off its way, and it will fly to the target maybe, and then you can retrieve the information there. And this RFC like states some very good technical properties systems like this have. For example, that the carriers have an intrinsic collision avoidance system, which increases availability, right? Or that multiple types of service can be provided with a prioritized pecking order. So this could be used like to prioritize certain types of information over another. It says that with time, the carriers are self-regenerating, which is a nice property to have for a network. And an additional property is built-in worm detection and eradication. And some time ago, a user group, like a Linux user group in Norway, I think, actually implemented this system. And they got the pigeons, and they set up all of the required infrastructure, and then tried doing a ping command from one node to the other. This is the result. You will see that they tried to send 9 data packets here. And I mean, the runtimes of these ping commands are, it's like most often over an hour or something to like for the pigeon to go to place B and return. So yeah. And only 4 of these packets arrived back. So they state here that they have 55% packet loss. But it works. Yeah. Another RFC is 6592, the null packet. This specifies null packets which are neither sent nor acknowledged when not received. There is like an informal definition where they say that the null package is a zero-dimensional packet and that it exists since it is non-self-contradictorily definable. Then in this specification follows the formal definition, but it's intentional zero of the, then there's a reference null, in the end of this document, there is like a list of references and related work, and there is like the key null, which points to an empty string. So this is all you need to know about the null packet. It goes on and lists some properties of this packet, for example, that it is inherently good. The null packet cannot have the evil bit set by definition. Consequently, it is rather clear and undeniable that the null packet is harmless, having no evil intent. Now, what is the evil bit? You might ask. RFC 3514, let's look at that one. The authors of this RFC noticed that the definition of an IP fragment, this is about IPv4, has a single bit which is not used for anything. It's just undefined. It doesn't carry any meaning. And the authors thought, we should change that and apply some meaning to this bit. So here is the layout of this field. Yeah, it's the first bit in this sequence, and they give it like this shorthand E for evil bit. It can have two possible values. If it's set to 0, the packet has no evil intent. Hosts, network elements, etc. should assume that the packet is harmless and should not take any defensive measures. And another possible value is 1. If this bit is set to 1, the packet has evil intent, and secure systems should try to defend themselves, while insecure systems may choose to crash, to be penetrated, etc. And then this RFC goes in great detail about how exactly and in which situations this bit should be set. For example, if you are doing pen testing on a system, trying to attack it, you should set this bit so that the receiving system will recognize that this packet has evil intent and can take defensive measures, right? You must do this if you are attacking. Yes. And yeah, here's just a list of some more fun RFCs. If you're interested in this stuff, you should check them out. This one is the Hypertext Coffee Control Protocol, HTCPCP, which like gives some specific HTTP requests, for example, to make sure that a coffee pot which is connected to the internet, like you can request to know its status, yeah, whether it's empty or full and how full it is and stuff. And this is also where the HTTP code 418 comes from, which says, I'm a teapot. Yeah? If you try to send a packet like that to a system which is actually a teapot, it can reply with this, and this is an error. Sure. There is an RFC for TCP options to denote packet mood. So this allows you to set a specific mood in a TCP packet if under some circumstances, I don't know, you're building a software and the software notices that there is a lot of delay in your communication or stuff. It could set an annoyed mood in the packets it's sending to let the other system it's communicating with know. And then the system could respond to that accordingly. And there is an RFC called Scenic Routing for IPv6, which suggests that traffic should be sent over specific very nice pathways, yeah, along a nice landscape and in a lot of fresh air, for example. It says to prioritize communication channels that are wireless, for example, to give the data like a very scenic pathway to its destination. That's the RFCs I wanted to show you. You will find in like a Wikipedia article with a list of April Fool's RFCs. If you're interested, there are like several dozen of those. You can take those out. Yeah.
I especially love the packet mood when we think about upcoming AI. Right. That might be interesting, so it can communicate how it feels. I don't know. Maybe that's good. Maybe it's not good. Who knows? All right. So, to dig a bit into game development and indie game development, and while doing some research, I stumbled upon some people who coded their own fancy, interesting interesting applications. And so there are three short videos I wanted to show you around a bit. And all three of them, I think they are very interesting because they try to implement game worlds that could not exist in our world and are very different. And that's quite mind-bending if you walk around there and interact with stuff. So this is the first one. It's actually it's called Non-Euclidean Game, which is I think is not really correct because I think the it would be still Euclidean distances in an Euclidean room. But as you can see, you can make photos of the scene and then put that photo in the scene and suddenly everything appears there. And that's yeah, like it's super mind-bending and super fun to play around with that. And so far I've just found that video and no really playable version, but maybe there's one now. And here also, for example, like gravity gets applied to stuff that it placed in the scene. And it's just, yeah, it's just super fun and crazy to watch. I think it would like this scenario. I think that would be a really nice puzzle game. All right, that's the first example. Second one is this one, and this is actually really a non-Euclidean room, basically. You can imagine it works a bit like, for example, Hermione's bag or the TARDIS, where something looks small from the outside and very big from the inside. So he made some tunnels that have this effect. So this one looks super large from the outside, but actually when you walk through it, it's quite short. Or this one, this is the opposite one. Yeah, it looks super, super small from the outside and extremely large from the inside. And I think the YouTube channel is called CodePen. And he has a lot of different versions of that. So this is also a nice example. So you have rooms and you can walk in a circle. And the longer you walk, you start to realize it's just three rooms. There's just the blue one, the red one, and the green one. But the shape of the, let's say, house lets you think there should be at least four rooms, but it's just three. So you can do these crazy effects. And I don't want to spoil you too bad. Ooh, I made something full screen that I didn't want to have full screen. Give me a second. Here we go. I think it's Code Parade, sorry, exactly. So check out the videos because he does a lot of fun examples. If you continue here, he also has a version where he still has these tunnels, but some let shrink everything when you go through it. So everything, when you come out at the end, everything's smaller or everything gets bigger. That's also super fun. And I can see him making super fancy puzzle games with that. And we're already at the last one, which is a world in hyperbolic space. And it's also, yes, it's really fascinating for me to look at because when you walk around here, everything is bended so weirdly, because when you think you could look at the sky, it just wraps around you. The world wraps around you. So you see, I don't know, the other end of the world is on top of you. And this is just, it's just so crazy to walk around there. I always have a bit of problems with motion sickness, and I think this would not make it better for me, but it's so fun. And also, I think in a few seconds, he will also check out the house more. And when you start to walk into or to in front of that house, it's just crazy. And it's hard to imagine why it should look like now he's moving backwards. And then he reaches a point where he's basically from the world side on the opposite side of the house. So the house starts warping around him. That's super funky. And I think game engines and games are a perfect medium to experience such mathematically fun ideas that you can have. And I think some Operation Mindfuck talks back, Blinry also explained a 4D puzzle game.
That in the very first the one, same. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that goes like in the same direction as these games and these test engines. All right.
I heard that it takes a long time to build these types of games because there are basically no pre-made tools for you. You have to do everything yourself.
I guess if you want to
model a four-dimensional object or a hyperbolic one. You have to mm-hmm. code your own rules for that, basically. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's really fun to look at. I also have some geometric things I wanted to show you related to topology. That's a field of mathematics where you are looking like more at the geometric structure of the object and not its concrete, precise, like dimensions, for example. Yeah. There's this joke that for a topologist, there's basically no difference between a coffee pot and a donut, because if you like all substance which you can squeeze and pull, you can kind of transform the cup into a donut without making any cuts or without gluing anything together. Yeah. That's often the rules in like topologic transformations, that you cannot create additional holes. And because this shape only has a single hole going through it in the middle of the donut or in the handle of the cup, these are basically the same object topologically speaking, right? And yeah, then you can do interesting observations with this. A really well-known example is the Möbius strip, where you take a long piece of paper and you glue the ends together. But before you do that, you rotate the strip, like one end of the strip once, and then you like paste it together. And then this is an object that has an interesting property. It only has one side. Yeah, if you would take a pen and start drawing on the top of the surface here and follow it along the strip, you would like get behind the ring here and draw, and then get on front here again. And then as you wrap around, you are now at the back side of the strip, and you are like kind of opposite to where you started, but you're still not done. Yeah, you're still drawing. You can go behind here and then under this and on the top side, on the back side of this, and then if you wrap around you where you started, and you made a long line, and you do the all of the surface in one stroke, basically, because there's only one of them. There is really fun stuff that happens if you try to cut into this strip. I have a video and can try to find a good point where you can see it. So this person is taking a Möbius strip and then using scissors to cut along the like the middle line of the strip, starting to cut, and after cutting around the strip once, it doesn't fall apart into two pieces. It's just still a single strip. Yeah, single strip. Wow, surprise, right? And yeah, the same thing could be done if you took a strip of paper and twisted it twice before gluing it together, and then you start cutting in the middle. I really touch for yourself if you're interested. It's another really surprising thing that happens if you do that. But the thing I really wanted to show you is this one. This was in a tweet I found the other day, and I thought, I have to note this down into the list of ideas for Operation Mindfuck, because it's so surprising. This tweet stated that if you have this like double donut shape, and there is a long rod going through one of the holes, like this is an infinitely long rod where you can't go over the edges of it, then the tweet said that it's possible to transform this shape so that the rod goes through both holes. And I said, what? There's no way this is possible. And then I clicked on the tweet and looked at the video. Let's do that. Huh. Let's look at it again. It's 7 seconds. Right. So by pushing and squeezing in the right way, you can actually get to a state where this rod goes kind of through both of these holes. And this is not a trick. Yeah. This is really like a property of this shape that you can transform it in this way. This is kind of a like proof by example, which feels a bit unsatisfying to me, and this really makes me want to learn more about topology to like kind of in a formal way state what's going on there. But I guess the trick to kind of understand why this works is like somewhere in the middle of this transformation, you get to the state where you have this shape that's basically like a symmetric, it's rotationally symmetric. Yeah, if you hold the bottom and the top part with your fingers, then you can imagine that like the middle of this object is hollow, and there are three holes going in from the side. One is from the front, one is from the back left, and one is from the back right. And all of these holes connect to the interior of this hollowed out shape. Yeah? And this rod is now going through two of those, to the back, to the tube. And if you're at this stage, you kind of, it's up to you to choose in which direction you want to go. You can either like take the front hole and like pull it out and stretch it to make it really large and kind of disappear into the edge of the shape. And then you get in this situation, yeah, where you have this rod peeking through both holes at the back, basically, and the front one, you can't really see it anymore. But you can also, if you're at this position, you can choose to take kind of the like the right handle of this shape and push it inwards to go between the other two handles. And then it's a situation where you arrive finally at a shape like this one, where it appears to go through only one hole. But yeah, this is just this weird property of this object that you can do topological transformations to go in both directions. And I think that's really fascinating and not very intuitive. And there is a second thing like that, where you start with this kind of pretzel-like shape, which is like interlinked into itself. And then the question is, can you transform this in a state where the handles are free? And it turns out that you can, which is also, again, really surprising. And this is like this diagram shows how to do it. You would start taking these two holes, which interlink, and start stretch them out, yeah? Stretch them down, make them larger until they almost touch at the bottom here. And then you have this thing, string of material, which you can still remain between these two holes. And then you're at a state where you have this little twists in the material. Now, then you can just start untwisting this. You twist once here, and you twist twice, and then it's free. And then you can make the hole smaller again until you are at this stage. And yeah, I think that's pretty cool. And yeah, that's the topologic things I wanted to show. Bina.
That's so cool. Oh man, I could look at these forever. Like, also that clay animation with the rod. It's nice to have an animation. It's a bit easier to get this into my
still
head.
After looking at it for 10 times. It's so crazy.
Yeah, completely. All right, we already reached our last section, which is about PCB art. So this year, I tried to learn more about PCB design and electronics. And I found that nice little community about people who like to make very artsy PCBs. For example, here's a person who made a very nice schematic and image. What possibilities you have with PCB. So if you I'm not sure, maybe you have had one in hand. A PCB usually has like a base plate, which has a yellowish color, and on top and on the bottom of this plate you have a copper layer, and on top of these so you can have a solder mask, which is some sort of plastic coating that you can cover contacts that you, because you don't want to have every part of copper traces be open to the air or open to touch. So you might want to cover that. So this is the solder mask. In this example, this would be the purple color. And also maybe you can have some screen printing on top. This is usually in a white or in a black color. In this example, it's white. So you can have a lot of different combinations of these materials. Like you can have the copper and then put on solder mask, for example. And you will get a lighter color. This is the number 4 in this case. And if you mill away the copper and just put the solder mask onto your base plate, you will get usually the darker color. Now this would be the number 5. And then also you can have either just the base plate. This would, I think in this example, it's number 3. And you can also the copper that is open to the air or to touch usually gets a coating, and often this is silver, gold, or some what's it called in English when you solder. Yeah, which is also like a silverish color. And yeah, and the screen printing, which is some white or black. So these five sort of colors are your color palette that you can play with. And when you go to different manufacturers, you can also get different solder mask colors. I think the very typical one would be green. This example it's purple. You can also get blue or black or white, whatever you want. And yeah, get your stuff manufactured. That's super easy. And there's also some nice examples what else you can do, because you have these two-layer PCBs with copper on both sides. You can leave copper out on one side only on certain places and leave it out on the other side completely. So you can get a very fancy shine-through optic. Also, of course, when you work with electronics, you can very distinctively place some light sources on your board if you want to play with certain ways of lighting. So that's fun. And also, as you can see on the dried image, you can choose your cutout shape any way you want. The manufacturers are usually quite open and can do, I guess, most of the shapes. And they can mill in extremely fine details, especially if they want to mill the copper on the copper layer. And that's super interesting, because when you design PCBs, you often want to have very extremely fine traces. And this is interesting for art, of course, because you can ingrain extremely fine details, like this very nice example of a half broken down leaf, where the copper layer is used to have the fine veins that are still intact, and a solder mask is used to have a bit of like whole leaf cells that are starting to break down. And the yellowish color that you can see, that's the color of the base plate. So you can create extremely fine details. That's super fun. And then there's, for example, Boltport. I can highly recommend Boltport. He does a lot of extremely crazy PCB art. And this one, I think, is also very nice. It's a chameleon, and he uses the PCB not only as the base material, but also he uses it in a very innovative way, I'd say, because he uses it upright. This is quite unusual. And you can see that he soldered the LEDs on the edge of the PCB to give that chameleon a nice LED back row of lights. That's super fun. And he also somehow got two solder mask colors on one PCB. I'm not sure who he contacted to get that. That's rather unusual, but it seems that it can be done. And he also used resistors for little feet. That's also really nice. So he thought about integrating parts into the shape of the end design that are usually more functional and not used aesthetically. And that's really interesting and really nice. And he has a lot of these projects, and I think you can also buy them as DIY kits. And that's really nice. And if you can combine all these layers, this is a project that I came up with because, as I said, I really like to do generative art. And of course, you can then start to write code that generates shapes and patterns that you can put on your PCB for aesthetic reasons. And these boards that you can see here, they were produced or created generatively or procedurally, you would maybe say. And these three planets, they act as capacitive touch buttons, so you can touch on them and it gets recognized by the MCU on the board. And yeah, it's really fun for me when I work with generative art to find a new material, but you need to figure out how to use it. And PCBs are just a super different material than paper or other stuff. And it's also really nice that you get these high quality coatings like gold or silver that makes stuff a lot more valuable and really nice to look at. So yeah, I can highly recommend the hashtag PCBArt on Twitter and Instagram, where a lot of people are posting really, really nice stuff. All right, and I think it's time for us to wrap up.
Yeah, on our last slide, we thought, because we are sending you into all kinds of rabbit holes anyway, that's what we're trying to do. We might as well list some of them and like very quickly mention them and just maybe see what sticks in your heads. This is very mean. So mechanical keyboards. There are huge communities around building your own keyboards, like picking different keycaps, different switches, different layout. You could look into that. Some people are really interested in skincare and look into like what different products do and their ingredients. There's communities around this. Amateur astronomy. You can, if you know where to look, you can find some really cool things on the galaxy, which you can just see without any instruments if you're in a good environment. You can try baking your own bread. You can like make your own sourdough with bacteria just from the air and use it to bake your bread. Some people are into backpacking and optimize for weight. So they try to have equipment that weighs as little as possible so that they don't have to carry as much. And then come up with really interesting shapes for their tents where they spin these thin tarps basically between trees, for example, with ropes to sleep under that. And if you have like, if you're into cooking and you have these dull knives, which you're always annoyed about, you can get whetstones, like, which is this abrasive material, and you put water on it, and then you can like remove material from your knives to make it sharp. There are really good like YouTube videos about that. And with that, we say thank you for listening to this. Greetings to the future, I guess. I hope you're having a good remote chaos experience right now. And you have a link to the slides here if you're interested in any of those. And I guess, thanks for being here. And see you soon.
All right. Bye.